In this episode, I will show you how to easily lower your A1C to 5 and under, and most importantly, keep it there. We will cover the critical steps that are required, the foods and nutrients needed, and the three physiological components that must be met. Once you understand these basics, your blood sugars will be well controlled. Emotional daily swings will end. Health markers like blood pressure, triglycerides will normalize. The added bonus? You can and will lose body fat and gain muscle all at the same time, changing your health forever. Welcome to the Resilient Diabetic. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And if you have learned something new today, please smash that like button for me. This is the third episode of a three-part series. The first is called What Are the True Causes of Diabetes? I'll put a link in the description box below if you've missed the first two. This is where I go over why some become type 2 insulin resistant diabetics, while others who eat the exact same things do not. Why someone can be overweight, maybe even obese, yet never become diabetic. Yet others of normal weight, one can even have low levels of subcutaneous body fat levels, yet still develop high blood pressure, heart disease, and type 2 diabetes. This second episode covered the next critical steps in the process. Once diagnosed as a diabetic, and it does not matter the type, why would you want to keep your A1C to 5 and under? What are the hurdles, the misunderstandings, and the treatments your healthcare team will present? The American Diabetes Association defines diabetes as a progressive disease. This ultimately means they expect your diabetes will get worse over time. Your healthcare team is not there to ensure your quality of life, that you live that life free of any complications. That is your job to take charge and learn how to heal your own body. They are only there to medicate you based on how progressively worse your diabetes gets. Today, we will cover the last component. How do you easily lower your A1C to 5 and under? I have personally learned so much on this journey once diagnosed as a diabetic, and I'm here to share the mistakes I've made, and they have been many. And this is the path that you must take too. Not only learn from your mistakes, but become objective with how your body responds to each one of your corrections. Diabetes is a disease of the diet. You will, over time, come to realize one critical overriding law. The philosopher Hippocrates could not have said it any better, and I'll quote him, "Let thy food be your medicine." Good food is medicine. Bad food will need you to take more and more medicine. So regardless of what anyone says, it will be the right diet first and foremost that will save your life. Not fasting, not supplements, and not even exercise can help if the wrong food choices are being made. In order to get and keep your A1C to 5 and under, there are three critical components we must address. First, because everything hinges on this, we must not only keep blood sugars low in those non-diabetic ranges, but have that nice flat line readings throughout the day. Here's an example of my blood sugar readings today. We want to prevent the violent whiplashing of blood sugars up and down like a roller coaster. These violent swings in blood sugars not only impact your life expectancy, but your day-to-day experiences. the angry mood swings, the constant hunger pangs, work productivity losses, relationship issues, depression, to even one's sexual drive and health. It is devastating. Second, and one of the most overlooked components, we want to feel satisfied throughout the day, not obsessing over food. Because if you're constantly hungry, then you're constantly miserable. Most of you have tried exactly what your doctors have ordered. And what is that? We need you to eat less and exercise more. This advice then leads you to even more hunger. Thus, your weight yo-yos up and down year to year. The end result? Your diabetes gets worse and your metabolism slows. Lastly, in order to keep that A1C down, we need to keep the most valuable asset we have as diabetics, our muscle tissue. And when does that process of sarcopenia or muscle loss begin? It actually begins when we are in our 30s. The number one correlation to longevity is muscle mass and strength, because basically the stronger you are, the more you can survive certain diseases. After you've eaten a meal, remember it is also that muscle tissue that soaks up all of those sugars or glucose. It is that muscle tissue that keeps your metabolism high. If you put on 1 pound of new type 2 muscle fibers, studies have shown you can literally burn up to 300 calories in your sleep. Muscle tissue is very metabolically active and it constantly burns calories even at rest. Muscle protein synthesis and muscle protein breakdown are influenced by two major factors. First is physical activity, and second are macronutrient intake of specifically protein. You need more protein in your diet as you age, not less. In the quest to understand my own diabetes and get my A1C to 5 and lower, there were mistakes made. I had to walk the walk first, try different approaches, so now we can talk the talk. When I was first diagnosed 8+ years ago, I was in really bad shape. What added to my complications? That was the substandard lab work done by my healthcare team. It was atrocious. They initially typed me as a type 2 diabetic and subsequently put me on all the wrong medicines. You can see how horrific my blood sugars were at the time of diagnosis. I had an average blood sugar of around 263 with an A1C of 10.8. The problem? I was actually a type 1 diabetic due to an autoimmune attack which destroyed my pancreas. It just came on later in life. After the initial incorrect diagnosis, I still knew something was not right. So I took charge of my health care and immediately I kept demanding an endocrinologist, one who understood autoimmune diseases and how to test for them, which I finally eventually did. During this turmoil and in the meantime, I had one major advantage over everyone else in my shoes: my university nutritional degree. So I immediately knew what needed to be done to lower my blood sugars, which was to drop my carbohydrate intake. I also at the same time, without hesitation, increased my protein intake. After that long battle with my general practitioner for the right care, and once I was properly diagnosed as an insulin-dependent type 1 diabetic and then put on the right types of basal and bolus insulins, then and only then was I really able to lower my blood sugars. Was I in control to my standards? Absolutely not at first, because this is where I personally made my first critical mistakes. I then literally took the playbook out of my own nutritional courses of how to treat diabetes. Now that I'm on insulin, I could safely add in the quote-unquote healthy foods like oatmeal, beans or lentils, even starches like potatoes or any vegetable for that matter. Boy, was I wrong. Not only did I create severe hunger all the time, my blood sugars were whiplashing up and down. I even had severe hypoglycemic events, low blood sugars, that nearly put me in the hospital. The worst part? I just got fatter and my health blood markers got worse and worse. My triglycerides went way up. My good cholesterol, the HDL, dropped. My blood pressure skyrocketed. The more carbs I ate, the more insulin I required, the worse my overall health became. And here's the irony. If I had become a clinical dietitian with my degree, this is the same advice I would have given my diabetic patients. That is, until I became a diabetic. For example, the two foods in particular every healthcare professional claim are great for diabetics because they are high in fiber, which in the real world I found to be the hardest to control blood sugars are, drum roll please, oatmeal and lentils and beans. I quickly knew this high carb diet model was not the right approach because it failed to account for two critical components of human biology. The first biological trait we all have, and it's a word that's kind of hard to pronounce, satiety. You've heard me talk about this many times before. The second hardwired genetic trait we all share is based on the protein leverage hypothesis. This is now considered to be the single most important attribute to your diet and whether or not you maintain great health free of any complications for the rest of your life. Critical new studies show that those who understand these two concepts not only easily manage their weight, but get this, they are able to build muscle, lose fat, and most importantly, control their blood sugars. They do not become part of the statistics of worsening health that afflict most diabetics. Again, in other words, you are no longer that progressive diabetic. Let's start off with the word satiety. Not exactly the easiest word for me to say, but it ultimately comes from the Latin word satis, which means enough. Have you ever considered and critically analyzed how you feel after you've eaten a meal or a snack? This feeling of satisfaction is not created by a single mechanism. Instead, it's a combination of several physiological and psychological factors all working together. This would include the physical sensation of your stomach expanding as you eat. It also includes how food smells, tasted, along with the sensory component of that meal. Lastly, the way our hormones and neurotransmitters in our gastrointestinal tract respond to the food we're eating. It sends signals back to the brain, letting it know that it now has all the valuable nutrients it needs for repair, growth, and recovery. The brain then shuts off all the hunger mechanisms. Let me repeat this very important point. It's not really about the calories the body cares about, but the nutrients in the foods we eat. It wants nutrient-dense foods. In other words, foods that are naturally low in energy, but high in nutrients. These feelings of satisfaction will ultimately unconsciously influence how soon and how much food and calories you will eat within a day's period. The reason the high-carb, low-fat, or even the low-carb, high-fat diet plans eventually fail is because the macronutrient that gets ignored the most, yet has the most powerful effects on satiety, is protein. Both these diet camps would benefit immensely from learning about the protein leverage hypothesis. Simply stated, due to our evolution of species, the protein leverage hypothesis predicts we as humans will always prioritize protein first when regulating total food intake. The real world implications is that if we don't consume adequate protein, we will overconsume other foods high in carbohydrates and or fats in a subconscious effort to obtain those critical missing amino acids. As protein gets diluted by carbohydrates in the modern food supply, we must keep eating more and more carbohydrates to gain that limited protein. So you will just keep on eating and eating and eating. How do we put this all together? Simple. First and foremost, all your meals have to have a substantial servings of lean protein sources. And I'm not going to mince words here. Lean animal sources, not plant-based. If we're going to do this, then do it right. That will do four things for you. One, provide satiety so you're not hungry all day. Two, it would help regulate blood sugars beautifully, keeping you flatlined. Third, it will help retain your muscle tissue. Without muscle, your diabetes will only get worse. Fourth, animal protein sources are extremely dense in not only the right kinds of amino acids and or building blocks your body needs for repair and recovery, but also contain most of all the vitamins and minerals your body relies on too. Fiber from the right foods is the other key. And I've also found a diet with the right nutrients, fiber-rich vegetables, which again, are the vegetables that are low in carbohydrates, but are extremely packed with vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants, will provide just enough glucose to completely satisfy the body. And what vegetables are those? These are the above ground. Let me repeat that for you. They grow above ground. Non-tuber, non-starchy vegetables. Do a Google search for those key terms. Write them down. Low carb, above ground vegetables. Every meal I eat, which is between 3 to 4 a day, has both a lean source of protein from either chicken, beef, fish, eggs, or turkey, along with a serving of these above ground vegetables. I also do rely heavily on green leafy vegetables, including salad-based greens. I personally think of food not as a reward, but as nutrients to fuel and build the body. So I generally do eat the same foods every day. That is the final key to all this. Yes, eating the same nutrient-dense foods every day as a base will make your diabetes easy to control. Why? Because now you've got predictability. I will, however, mix up the vegetables like green beans one day, maybe broccoli or cauliflower the next. Use the most valuable tool you have in your arsenal to determine your response and the amounts of foods you can eat. Your glucose meter, or in my case, my CMG or continuous glucose meter. You have to remember, the right foods are medicine. So I bet many of you have additional questions like, how much protein does a diabetic need per day? What are the best kinds of proteins? I will set up a playlist for you with all the answers to those questions. I'll even expose more deceit and misunderstandings. Doctors and nutritionists are still taught to this very day about this vital macronutrient. The first link you will see is to subscribe to this all-important, life-changing channel. The second is the link to the playlist on protein. So, have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released bi-monthly. Bye for now.